Mukunda Hari, Mukunda, I think the CDs of the classes, we will give it free to all the all the participants. Also, this is going to be the last session in a way, because the next session is going to be, you will be speaking, not me. And some of you will be requested to speak about your realizations from the classes. Just let me see a show of hands. Who would like to speak about your realizations? How many? Raise your hands, those who want to speak about your realizations. Okay. And so then I will request those who want to speak, please write it down. Because you know why. Because if you don't write, if you speak, it takes up a lot of time. Because you have to kind of, when you put them in writing, then they are also, the thoughts are more more clear and focused, and so that, you know, there's so many people, so many devotees wanted to present. So that session will be for 1 hour, and then the next session you will come to me and I'll give you a gift. I mean, next session means next 1 hour. And yes, and then we'll have a feast as usual. And today I won't be able to be in the temple at 7 to do the kirtan, because tomorrow I am giving initiation to about 75 devotees getting first initiation. And yeah, it's horrible to you, but and there are about 36 second initiation candidates. And and the main thing is, as I said, you know, like, it's not horrible to me because I didn't prepare anything, you know. So because I was so busy last few days, like, which actually initiation needs a lot of preparation. Fortunately, I chanted on the beads. That I have done. But, you know, like selecting names and, you know, speaking to the devotees, I didn't get a chance to speak to the candidates. And anyway, so since tomorrow is initiation and I didn't prepare, I have to take the time to prepare myself tonight and tomorrow morning. So that's why I won't conduct the morning session. I mean, rather, kirtan session this evening. What's your general feeling about coming here and being here and participating in these programs? Is it? You're not saying it just to please me, though. Hare Krishna. Okay, so Bhagavatam, how many cantos does Bhagavatam have? 12 cantos. So we tried to cover so far about till yesterday 10th canto, not fully, but I mean just touched, and tried to discuss about or remember some of the important episodes from the 10th canto. And then 11th canto is a very important one. was it last year, the 11th canto, the seminar was on 11th canto. Just the entire seminar was on 11th canto, which is Krishna's instructions to Uddhava. And it's a very, very important chapter, which is known as Uddhav Gita. We know Bhagavad Gita, but this is another Gita where Krishna speaks to Uddhav. And so someday we will discuss about 11th canto separately. So today, just in one session, I'll try to cover the 12th canto, and it is the end of Srimad Bhagavatam. So 12th canto basically deals with Srila Sukadeva Goswami predicting the kings of this earth. You know, he is forecasting who would be the king, generations after generations, you know, like he's talking about the kings of this earth planet and their nature, their characteristics, and how the description of numerous faults of this age of Kali. This is the age of Kali. It's a very, as you know, the Kali Yuga is a very degraded age. It's an age of adharma. It is the ocean, it's an age which is described as the ocean of sin. The whole, like if you consider sin as a substance, then we are submerged in an ocean of sin. There's all around us, there's an ocean of sin, and we are in the middle of it. We are at the bottom of it. Kaler doshe nidhe rajan. That's the situation of the age of Kali. And then the third chapter of this 12th canto goes into a chapter called Bhumi Gita. Mother Earth is speaking. And she is actually presenting it very sarcastically, that all these kings and all these powerful individuals, they are trying to control this earth planet. But she's laughing at them. That you are trying to control the earth, control this world with your tiny little ability and strength. And you are so proud of yourself. But eventually what will happen? For how long you are here? Uh, 70 years, 80 years, 100 years. Then you are gone. And you are trying to rule over the earth. You want to bring everything under your control. What is this 100 years? This 100 years, even compared to a day of Brahma, 100 years is just less than a minute, or little more than a minute actually. So just consider, our duration of our life is 1 minute, and we are thinking that we are going to do so much, we are going to control the whole planet. And like, that is how futile all our endeavors are. We are trying to bring everything under control. We are trying to make a very elaborate situation for our comfortable living. But, and then the next chapter, Sukadeva Goswami is describing the different types of annihilations. Like, see, we are always subjected to annihilation. There are four different types of annihilation. One annihilation is a continuous annihilation. We are actually going through a continuous annihilation. Our bodies is constantly changing, right? This is one type of annihilation, constantly changing, which means the cells in our body, part of our body is dying. Then eventually we die, individual annihilation. We are gone, we are annihilated. Then partial annihilation. This whole structure of the universe up to the heavenly planets goes through annihilations. The dev through fire or through water. Like they are known as pralaya. The water inundates, everything goes under water. Just consider, if this planet is covered over by water, what will happen? Everything is finished. Another type of annihilation is through fire. Lord Shankarshan breathes fire from his mouth, and as a result of that, everything is destroyed. Everything is burnt. Even the higher planetary systems feel the heat. Like Mahaloka, Sattaloka, Janaloka, Tapaloka do not annihilate in that way, but they feel the heat of that annihilation. And then there is total annihilation when Brahma dies. Brahma lives for 100 years. What is Brahma's calculation of time? Our calculation is, or general calculation is, the four yugas. Like, how does time move? Did you ever notice? Time moves in cycles. After 1 second comes another second, right? Then it goes to the next higher concept, minute. After 1 minute comes another minute, and it goes on and on and on. Then hours, days, months, years. Then 432,000 years is the duration of Kali Yuga. 432,000 years. Then Dwapar Yuga, 864,000 years. Treta Yuga, 1,296,000 years. And Satya Yuga, 1,728,000 years. So these four yugas comprise one of the biggest cycles. Called Divya Yuga. One four yugas together is one Divya Yuga. And then the Divya Yuga goes into thousand such Divya Yugas make a day of Brahma. According to that calculation, there are months, years, and Brahma lives for 100 years. Then Brahma also dies. And when Brahma dies, this universe disintegrates. Universe is finished. So that is, in a way, total annihilation. It even goes further. Mahavishnu is glancing towards the material nature. When Mahavishnu withdraws his glance, whole material creation becomes unmanifest. So in one hand we are seeing how insignificant our existence is, and on the other hand we are seeing how we are susceptible to various types of annihilations. So, okay, then it gradually goes into Sukadev Goswami's final instructions to Parikshit Maharaj. And then Parikshit Maharaj leaves his body. Bhagavatam in a way begins with Parikshit Maharaj being cursed, and now Parikshit Maharaj, in an illustrious way, Parikshit Maharaj prepared himself for death. Through that, what do we learn? Through that, don't we learn how to leave our bodies? Given a choice, the doctor says, you have 7 more days to live. What are you going to do? Did you find any answer to that? Or you just don't want to think about it? How many of you just don't want to think about it? No one. Learned assembly. And how many of you feel that you learned how to prepare yourself for that occasion? Very good. So that is why this Srimad Bhagavatam is so important. It is teaching us how to leave our bodies. Srila Prabhupada himself, I had the good fortune of seeing how Srila Prabhupada left his body. Yesterday I was describing, just a few days before Srila Prabhupada left his body, he couldn't even turn to his side. His body was so weak, he couldn't even turn to his side, he couldn't even lift his hand. He was in a very painful situation because lying on bed is not very, or not at all pleasing. This whole situation is so uncomfortable. But still at that time, even in that condition, just when his body is completely weak and is now ready to leave his body, Prabhupada was translating Srimad Bhagavatam. He couldn't hold the microphone himself. He could not hold the handset of the recorder. One of us used to hold the recorder, the handset in front of his mouth. And Pradyumna Prabhu used to read the verse, and Prabhupada used to give his translation of the verse and also the purports to the verse. So in this way we actually learn how to leave our bodies. But on the other hand, what's happening mostly nowadays? When you get to know we are going to die within such and such day or such and such period, our relatives pack us up, send us to the hospital, intensive care, to intensify our suffering condition. Once a doctor told me that what medical science is doing now is very advanced medical science today. But what is this very advanced medical science is doing is simply extending our suffering condition. Just extending our suffering condition. Wouldn't it be better to just leave the body and go? and get ready for the next body. But because people do not have any information about what happens after death, they just cling on to this body as long as they can, even though it is finished. Like, I mean, I hope I'm not being heartless. But just consider, you know, what's the use of just lying in the bed, in the intensive care, 25 needles and pipes stuck into your body, and you know, like you're just there, you don't know whether you're there or not. And the hospital bills keep on piling up. So please think about it, and I would suggest, don't succumb to that system. When a time comes, say, good riddance to the bad. Good riddance to this miserable condition of existence. At least that's what, I mean, I wish that I could do that. Before Prabhupada also, when he was quite sick, Prabhupada told me, in more than one occasion, Prabhupada told me, if I become unconscious, don't let anybody take me to the hospital. And of course, no one even thought of taking Srila Prabhupada to the hospital. But Prabhupada was so concerned, because if he became unconscious, of course, Prabhupada never became unconscious. Even till the last moment, Prabhupada was chanting the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. I had the good fortune to witness that myself. And at least I will say, if I become unconscious, please don't let anybody take me to the hospital. The Ayurvedic clinics are much better. That's why I set it up here. It just, you know, takes care of your body. But it doesn't give you the false promise that it'll make you immortal. It doesn't stick needles and pipes and everything to your already the city of nine gates. No more gates are needed in that body. We have plenty of holes in this body. And so say goodbye. And what do we actually learn? What is the real wisdom? Real wisdom is to recognize that this body has certain longevity. This body will last for some time. Just as a machine. This body is a machine. This body is a machine which is driven by the soul. And do you think when you buy a car, it's going to last forever? When the car gets old, and if you can afford it, then what do? Do you send your old car to the garage? Sometimes you do. But if you're rich, you don't do that. If you are very wealthy, and if you are in your right senses, even you can afford it, then what do? The moment that the car is about to go to the garage, get rid of it and buy a new one. Why hold on to the old car when you have the option to get a new car? Why hold on to the old body when you have an option to get a new body? So rather prepare for the nice body for the next life. Don't hold on to this old body. And when it's not functioning, what's the use? Extending the life. What's it called? Ventilator. I mean, even in my healthy state, I would like to have a thing like this in my body. Like artificially pushing oxygen to your lungs. And a big pipe shoved down your throat. Can you imagine? I mean, even in my healthy condition, I would like to have something. I can't even allow my finger to go down my throat. I feel like vomiting. And here it is just stuck into the mouth. You can't eat. Your nose food is being injected to your body. And see what they do. As soon as you go to the hospital, what do? They stick a needle. Right? And they tape it around your wrist. Why? Because they have to, instead of injecting time and time again, they just come and use that for whatever they have to inject. They think it's a very advanced thing, but don't get into that. Like once I had some heart problem, probably those who are from England, you know, and those like, they just wanted me to, they were hell bent on having, stent, to put a stent. And I just reflected onto Srila Prabhupada's instruction. Prabhupada also said, nothing should stick to his body. Nothing should penetrate his body. Which he meant that no needle should penetrate his body. Prabhupada didn't want anything to even penetrate his body, and he has a permanent thing right next to your heart. A permanent, you know, gizmo. Like stuck into your... I said, nothing doing. And many of my disciples in London, they were so keen on putting me into that, you know, like they're all ready to spend thousands of pounds, you know, like I told him, give me the money. And I really needed the money for Ujjain at the time. So that I can use the money better in Ujjain than giving it to these doctors. And finally I told them. And what actually really hit them hard, when I told them that, look, a hero dies once. A hero dies once. Whereas a coward dies many times. So do you want to be a coward? Just always afraid of death and dying at every second? Just die once and get rid of this, this body. They love that concept. And so that's the way to face our life. As long as your body is healthy, use it in Krishna's service. And when the body is old, non-functional, dilapidated, just say goodbye to it and get a new one. Just like you, if you have an old car, you discard it or sell it or whatever, and then get a new car and a better car. So let's do that. So Bhumi Gita was somewhat, in a way, was pointing, that's making the same point. That you are trying to control me, you are trying to exploit me, you are trying to enjoy me. But for how long? Rather, take advantage of this opportunity. This human form of life comes with an amazing opportunity. And that is In this life, you can become Krishna conscious and go back to Godhead. In this respect, I often think of an example. Should I tell you about that? I hope you are not getting bored. You see, Prabhupada gave that example of a fish out of water. You all are familiar with that. But did you ever go deep into that concept? The fish out of water? The fish in out of water, how will the fish feel? It will be in acute pain, intense agony. It will be writhing in pain. But when the fish is back into the water, then how does the fish feel? So now there's a little difference between us and that fish. You know what's the difference? Like, we are also fish out of water. But the difference is that the fish doesn't have any apparatus to deal with his condition on the land. Whereas we have. We are at a foreign place and we got an apparatus. Just consider, a fish got an apparatus. He puts it on. Right? And now fish can breathe inland. Now the fish can eat on land. Now the fish can do so many things. So now the fish is feeling, I'm so happy in that land. Only thing is that I have to get this nice house for me to live in. Only thing is, he gets the house and says, well, house, now I need a beautiful wife. So he gets a beautiful wife. Now I get some children. He gets the children. And there is, he got so stuck on the land that he forgot that he actually belongs to water. He is trying to create a comfortable situation on the land. And that is our condition. That's the difference between the fish out of water and we out of the spiritual world. We are not writhing in pain. We are not feeling that intense agony. Rather, we are thinking, tomorrow everything will be wonderful. So that is the difference. So that is why it's so difficult to go back to the spiritual world, where we actually belong. Rather, what we are doing, we are trying to find the perfect situation here, which is like the land for the fish out of the water. Makes sense? Realized it? What are you going to do about it? Still continue to make the perfect arrangement here? How many of you want to make a perfect arrangement here? You want to raise your hand? How many of you want to understanding the futility of your existence here would like to go back to where you came from? The fish back to water. Wonderful. Very nice. Very nice. So this is what Prabhupada is teaching us, and this is what Srimad Bhagavatam is telling us. This is what Mother Earth is reminding us. Boys and girls, you are a bunch of fishes, bunch of fish out of water. Don't try to make a perfect arrangement here. Recognize that I am Maya. Recognize that my business is to punish you. So I'm giving you the warning. Don't act in a wrong way, rather act on the right way, and I'll help you to do that. And then Maya, Mahamaya becomes Jogamaya and says, come, enter into Krishna's pastimes. So, okay. So then the second, Srimad Bhagavatam actually begins with that. The the kings of the earth. How many kings? So many generations of kings. And what will I won't go into the details of the kings, but I'll just try to explain the condition of this world, that it has been described as highway bandits will be ruling over this planet. The kings of this earth will be like highway bandits. Highway bandits, I don't know, like this concept, how it's taken in, will be taken. But in the Indian concept, you see, people used to go travel through road, and these bandits, these dacoits, used to hide by the side of the road. And when they would see a person traveling, they would catch him, they would kill him, and they'll rob all his wealth. In simple words, these robbers and bandits will become the rulers of this planet. The kings will become these kind of bandits, and what they will do? They'll rob the people. Do you feel that? Do you realize that? The governments, what the governments do? Impose taxes. Just impose taxes. Pay tax. And what they do with that money? They know that they are there only for 5 years or 4 years. In most cases, these leaders with their cronies, they try to collect, they try to loot as much money as possible. Because they take this as an opportunity to rob as much money from people as possible. The situation may not appear to be as bad as that, but that's how it's going to become. Just today I was discussing with whom we met yesterday, Sanjay. He's the chairman of Goldman and Sachs, and he's just right in the middle of that very high-powered financial world. And he was telling me that the progress for America was, although it was a capitalistic country and the capitalists don't want to spend money for anybody else generally, but the government was so fair that they forced these capitalists to benefit the people. And that's why America progressed so nicely. They forced these capitalists to build roads, build bridges, build schools, build libraries. And that's why America is America. So that was the early leaders. But what's happening today's leaders? Are they doing that? Whatever they're doing is simply for getting their votes. Those days they generally tried to help the mass, help the people of the country, not bribe the country. But now, what is happening? The political leaders are giving some sort of dole, some sort of bribing actually. See, I'm so good, give me the vote. This year I'm here, this term, next term bring me back. I'll give you more bribes. There was a big thing, of course I don't want to name anybody as such, but in America, anyway, who can miss it? There's a thing called Obama phone. That is, Obama started a system that whoever doesn't have a mobile phone, he can apply and he can get a mobile phone. I mean, why do they do things like that? Because to make these poor people think, oh, he is such a nice guy, he gave me a mobile phone. But how this mobile phone is going to help him? But these are just some political scams to get their votes. He may be a nice man, but the thing is that this is how it has come down to. He is giving all kinds of facilities for the underprivileged, because the number of underprivileged is more. By giving the benefits to the underprivileged, that's what happens to all the... Like, look what's happening in India. To get the votes, the minority, so-called minority, very soon they'll become the majority, the Muslims, they're just promoting them, giving them facilities. So this is the unfortunate state of affairs of today's world. And 5,000 years back, they broadcasted that, they predicted that. So that's the situation that we are in today, which has been predicted 5,000 years ago. And as the age of Kali progresses, the good qualities of men will diminish. As the age of Kali progresses, the good qualities will diminish. Isn't it happening? At least we know, I can say, the way I saw this world, I'm 70 now, and I think I can quite vividly remember things the way I was when 5-6 years old. So the way things were 65 years back, the world has been changed a lot. This world has changed a lot. Of course, I also changed a lot, but I can say that I changed for the better by coming to Krishna consciousness. But otherwise, the general condition, like for example, those days, if somebody drank alcohol, it was something like a worst possible thing that one can do. Divorce, we never heard of divorce. I never seen anyone divorced as such. I remember one lady in our neighborhood, and she was a very, what should I say, very sophisticated, very westernized, and that's the thing. She was a very westernized lady, very wealthy family, and she was divorced. That's the first time I heard the word divorced, that she was divorced. And we heard people are talking, oh, she was divorced. And we used to think, oh, she's divorced. Like it was something unusual. And nowadays, what to speak of divorce? They don't even get married. A consideration actually was in some time back, somebody took a statistics, and the statistics said that in ISKCON divorce rate is higher than the outside world. And it was, divorce rate in ISKCON is higher than the outside world. It's quite a shocking thing, to hear. The devotees are getting divorced, the divorce rate is higher in ISKCON than outside. But then one devotee who is quite conversant with the outside world, he said, that's because in outside world they don't get married. Because they don't get married, their separation is not counted. The man, woman living together without getting married. And that's another consideration that Bhagavatam very emphatically points out. The purpose of marriage. Why get married? To produce children. Mm. The marriage is not, long back I heard George Bernard Shaw define marriage. George Bernard Shaw's definition of marriage was legal prostitution. Now, should marriage degenerate into that? No, marriage is a holy, auspicious purpose. That is to procreate children. The purpose of a man and a woman coming together is to produce children. But producing children is not a consideration. See how degraded the society is becoming. And Bhagavatam is forecasting all that. Mind you, 5,000 years back, Bhagavatam is saying all these things. Now, procreation is not a consideration. And we can't really blame Bernard Shaw making such a blunt definition of marriage, or an apparently vulgar definition of marriage. Marriage is legal prostitution, legalized prostitution. But the thing is, because it is happening, that is what it has reduced to. No consideration for children. And if there is a possibility of getting a children, then abort it. So, should the human society degenerate into that? But we can't avoid it. In Kali Yuga, it is happening. And Srimad Bhagavatam is reminding us, and taking the message of Srimad Bhagavatam, Prabhupada is reminding us, don't lead a life like that. That is not human culture. That is not the human way of life. That is even worse than animal life. Even animals get together for procreation. Sex life in animal is just for the sake of procreation. Even the animals get together to procreate. But the human beings don't even get into that with that purpose. So in the age of Kali, almost everyone will become like Sudras. Asuddha Sudra Kalpahi Brahmana Kuli Sambhava. Even the Brahmanas will become like Sudras. And when Kali Yuga will end, when the Kali Yuga will almost come to an end, then the Supreme Personality of Godhead appear as Kalki Avatar. And he will annihilate all the miscreants. And mind you, at that time, the whole world will practically become full of miscreants. The entire population will become miscreants, sinful, fallen. So Kalki will annihilate them all. And he will revive the age of Kali. Age of Satyuga. So Satyuga will begin, Kali Yuga will end, and Satyuga will begin. And how will Satyuga begin? A handful of pious people that will be there, with them the Satyuga will begin. You can consider a handful of devotees of the Lord who will still be there. They will be spared. Kalki will kill everyone. Only they will be spared. The devotees of the Lord, the Vaishnavas, will be spared, and Satya Yuga will begin with them. And there is an astrological calculation also. You know, this is how accurate, how scientific these Vedic informations are. When Kali Yuga end and Satya Yuga begin, the constellation has been pointed out as when the moon, sun and Brihaspati enter simultaneously into one constellation and conjoin in the lunar mansion Pushya. There are lunar mansions, different lunar mansions. One is such mansion is called Pushya. And when sun, moon and Brihaspati simultaneously together will enter into the lunar constellation of Pushya, Kali Yuga will end and Satya Yuga will begin. See how those who are dealing with astrology, in a computer we can actually calculate now what's going to happen 427,000 years from now. Is there anyone into astrology here? Okay. Like, do you know how to calculate? That's okay. Can you give us a report? When exactly sun, moon and Brihaspati will enter into Pushya? Get your computer. Not now. And this is a challenge. Like, we also see Mahaprabhu's birth time is predicted. Mahaprabhu's horoscope is there. You know, you can go into that day, that time, that particular time, and you'll see the constellation was just like that. So this is how scientific and accurate these Vedic informations are. Another very important consideration. You know, two saintly kings are still alive. And they will be there at that time also. That means 427,000 years from now, these two persons will still be there. Their names are given. The one is Devapi, and the other is Maru, a descendant of Ikshaku in the Surya dynasty, the dynasty where in which Lord Ramchandra appeared. And you know who is Devapi? Devapi is Shantanu's brother. He is Bhishma Dev's father is Shantanu. So Devapi is Bhishma Dev's uncle. And they will become the rulers of the Satya Yuga when it will begin. The two kings are still there. Even now, two saintly Kshatriyas are living who at the end of this Kali Yuga will reinitiate the pious dynasty of the sun god Vivashan and moon god Chandra. There are two lines, sun, Surya Vamsa and Chandra Vamsa. One line is coming down from sun god Vivashvan and the other is coming down from the moon god Somdev. So these are the two dynasties, sun dynasty, moon dynasty. So in the sun dynasty, do you remember? Imang Vivashate Yogang Praktavan Aham Abhayam Vivashvan Manave Praho Manur Ikshaku Ve Abravit. So this Ikshaku dynasty. In Ikshaku dynasty, who appeared in this Ikshaku dynasty? Lord Ramchandra. So in that dynasty there was a king called Shantanu. And Shantanu's brother is Devapi. And in the Moon Dynasty, it will be Meru. Marudev. This has also been mentioned where they are. They're hiding, they're bidding their time incognito in a village named Kalapa. So we discussed already how Mother Earth sarcastically addressed the kings, and then it has been described that Dharma stands on four legs. We know all these concepts. Now we can see where these concepts are coming from. They are actually coming from the 12th canto. Dharma stands on four legs. What are those four legs of Dharma? Austerity, mercy, cleanliness, and truthfulness. And in Satya Yuga, all four legs were intact. In Treta Yuga, one leg broke. In Dwapar Yuga, two legs broke. In Kali Yuga, three legs are broken. And Dharma is standing on one leg. What is that leg of Dharma that Dharma is standing in this age? Truthfulness. But in this age, that also is dwindling. So that means Dharma will be completely lost. So in Satya Yuga, the goodness prevails. In Treta Yuga, passion prevails. In Dwapar Yuga, the mixed mode of passion and ignorance prevails. And in Kali Yuga, ignorance prevails. And as a result of that, most of the people in the age of Kali become Sudras. Sudras means those who cannot act, cannot function independently. They have to function, they have to act under the guidance of others. That is one aspect of a Sudra. The other aspect of a Sudra is he works for money. He works because he gets a salary. So that is the nature of a Sudra. Now don't we see that most of the people are looking for a job? Brahmanas don't work for others. He is independent, he has an independent occupation. Self-employed, as the polished term is. Self-employed. The Brahmanas are self-employed, Kshatriyas are self-employed, Vaishyas, the business people, are self-employed, but the Sudras need employment. So Sudras has to work for somebody. I know many of you are working. Please don't mind. It's not my words. It is. I am just simply saying what has been written in the scriptures. But won't it be better to just have an independent occupation? How many of you have independent occupation? Yeah. If somebody tells, take up a job, will you do that? No. So at least few people are not Sudras. And how many of you have become devotees? And depending upon Krishna. So you know what is their qualification? The Brahmanas. How many of you run your own kingdom? That is one varna that is missing in this age. No room for kshatriya. Democracy doesn't allow monarchy. But Vedic culture is monarchy. Monarchs, kings, but qualified ones. How many of you have your business? We asked, huh? So many of you have. Jamunacharya, you didn't raise your hand. Took it for granted, yeah? took it for granted, I know. Sunil Mohan, what about you? So, Rasa Rasik, halfway. Anyway, Surangi, you also didn't raise your hand. You're a big business lady. So I would suggest that most of you have already gone through your life, halfway at least. But make sure that your children don't become Sudras. Make sure that your children develop independent way of living. They don't have to depend upon anybody. Rather, they will provide job opportunities for others. Once a very big man, very big industrialist, came to see Srila Prabhupada. There is a very famous business industrialist family in India called Dalmias. Dalmias. Also very pious family. Jaidal Dalmia was the head of the family. And he came to see Srila Prabhupada in Vrindavan. He knew Srila Prabhupada from before. So he came to see Srila Prabhupada with his three daughters-in-law and a few grandchildren. Prabhupada at that time just started the Vrindavan Gurukul. And Prabhupada told him that he started the Gurukul. And he asked him to send his children to the Gurukul, his grandchildren, based on to get a job. And job, only a Sudra takes up a job. And Prabhupada said that your grandchildren don't need to take up any job from anybody. Your grandchildren should become leaders. But in order to lead, they must learn how to lead. And this school is going to train them. So that is the vision that Srila Prabhupada gave us about Gurukul. Gurukul is actually designed or meant to create leaders for the society. And Prabhupada pointed out that that your children should become leaders. They shouldn't take up a job. They should create job for others. Just as in your company, there are so many thousands of people are working. So why should your children go to that education system where they have to learn how to get a piece of paper that they can show and say, can you please give me a job? But that is the state of affairs in the age of Kali. Most of the people have become Sudras. But Prabhupada said that ISKCON is the institution that is designed to make Brahmanas all over the world. The highest class of individuals, intellectually most advanced, and those who are meant to become leaders of the society. And then it has been pointed out that Sukhdev Goswami, how Sukhdev Goswami's instructions made Parikshit Maharaj totally unafraid of death. Parikshit Maharaj came to the bank of the Ganges when he got to know that he will die within 7 days, being bitten by a celestial snake called Takshak, a terrible snake. But Sukadeva Goswami's instruction, what was Sukadeva Goswami's instruction all this while? Through Srimad Bhagavatam, what did we get? The first instruction that comes that way, if you look at it, that we are spiritual entities, we are spiritual beings, we are not this body. And we must develop our loving relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The identity and the existence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead has been firmly established beyond anyone's doubt that He does exist. And we have a loving relationship with Him. So to be situated, to be reinstated in that loving relationship is the goal of life. So when Srila Parikshit Maharaj received this knowledge from him, then he was fearless. As it is, he was fearless. But he is actually acting in this way, behaving in this way, simply to set an example for the posterity, for us, that we can learn, we can understand how to face death and what to do with our life. We got this human form. Has it been awarded to us with some objective and purpose, or is just an accidental happening that we are existing, that we are here? Is it just an accidental phenomena, or is it some objective? It has some purpose and objective. Human life has an objective. Like on the other hand, if you consider what is happening all over, people are just going through their life without any objective. They think, oh, okay, now we are studying, and then get a job, then get married. Just carry on doing the job. I know people who have been working for 45, 50 years. And the thing is that they just do that. And when they retire, I've been told that these people, they feel so frustrated, and all of a sudden their life is completely vacant. They've retired. Previously they were doing every day for about 45 years. Like every day he had been going to his office, taking the public transport, going to his office, doing certain things, coming back. Can you imagine? For about 40 years, his life has been like that. And when he went to his office, he was wondering, when will the Friday come? When will the Saturday come? And then I'll have one day holiday, Sunday. Like his whole life is revolving around one Sunday. From Monday till Friday, Monday till Saturday, he's just going the same transport, same time, probably the same breakfast, going to office, coming back from the office, spending some time with the family members or friends, and going to sleep. In the morning he gets up, goes to office. mean, it's really frightening to even think of it, yeah? But human beings adapt. Therefore, it's called conditioning. They get conditioned to it. That's the thing. And as I was saying, like for 40 years they've been doing it. Then all of a sudden, one day he retires. His office gives him a big farewell party. A real loyal servant. For 40 years he had been working without any deviation. And then the office says, company says goodbye to him. And he doesn't know what to do. Like he can't. Sometimes they do that. I know somebody who after retirement, you see, office time, the buses in Calcutta is very crowded. And he used to, after retirement, he used to go into that bus. And like you just ride the bus. He can't even stop in that particular area, particular place to go to the office, because sometimes he would go there, meet his friends and all, how are you doing? But he couldn't adapt to the new life, which is completely blank. Anyway, before that time comes, move into ISKCON temple. Enter into Banaprastha life. So that will be my sincere advice to you. Don't succumb to that kind of lifestyle. Lead your life centered around Krishna. Every day is so exciting. Every day is so exciting. And so that is the human life is meant for cultivating Krishna consciousness and be prepared. Be prepared for whatever comes. Because you know whatever comes will be more exciting. Whatever comes will be more rewarding. Whatever comes will be more pleasant. So that is the life of a devotee. Full of excitement. And you know, like, what the life of a devotee is? It's an eternal holiday. We lead a life of an eternal holiday. Once Kirtananda Swami was giving a class. Prabhupada used to make his disciples in the early days to give classes. So one day Prabhupada got Kirtananda Swami to give the Sunday feast lecture. Prabhupada was sitting there and listening. Kirtananda Swami at one point mentioned the life of Krishna consciousness is you chant and dance and do a little work. Do a little work. Prabhupada said, no, in Krishna consciousness there is no work. It's all fun. It's all enjoyment. Like whatever you're doing for Krishna is not work. It's your loving devotional service. When the mother takes care of the child, does she think it's work? No, it's a loving exchange with her son. So devotees, whatever they do for Krishna, it's their expression of the love for Krishna. There's no consideration for work. So that is what Krishna consciousness is. No work, an endless holiday. And it's fun, I tell you. Like, I can tell you, sometimes devotees write to me, they see my schedule, I didn't want to put it in my Ishtagoshti in the internet. But my secretaries and devotees keep on requesting, please tell me what is Guru Maharaj's itinerary. And so they write. And then I get some, oh Guru Maharaj, you are traveling so much. And you are, please take care of your health. And but if you ask me, I love it. I go to a new place, devotees are there, it's so wonderful to be with them. Like here I am with you. Isn't it fun? And when you came and you are with me and other devotees, isn't it fun? So this is how I'm always enjoying. So this is the way to lead your life. Sometimes people say, Maharaj, you're 70 years old, you don't look like. And sometimes I comment, you're 25 years old. Actually, that concept reminds me of Bernard Shaw. Somebody told Bernard Shaw, oh, you don't look your age. Bernard Shaw says, I look my age, you don't. And he made a very pertinent comment actually. He said, I look my age, but you don't. Because you have turned your stomach into a graveyard of animals, dead animals. Because you're a meat eater. Bernard Shaw was a vegetarian. He said, because you turned your stomach into the graveyard of dead animals. Anyway, so this is... like, it's not how old you are, it's the matter of how you feel. Sometimes people become old prematurely because of stress, the burden, and all that. Lead a life full of joy, full of happiness. Then Sukadev Goswami reminded Parikshit Maharaj, the concept that I will die is like that of an animal's feeling, mentality of an animal. A human being never thinks that I will die. Why? Because a true human being knows that he'll simply change his body. A real human being knows his real identity, being a spirit soul. When the body's subtle mental covering, this is very important actually. I would like to elaborate that point a little bit. Today I was thinking of taking some questions, but I think I just carry on. Is there anyone who is dying to present a question? You see, we have two bodies, the gross body and the subtle body. There are two material bodies, gross body and subtle body. The gross body is made of five gross elements, earth, water, fire, air, ether. And the subtle body is made of three subtle elements, mind, intelligence and false ego. So at the time of death, we leave our gross body. We leave our gross body. Gross body dies. Subtle body doesn't die. Subtle body doesn't die. Subtle body, even after death, the subtle body carries the soul to the next destination. Subtle body, in this way, is also imperishable, you can say. It doesn't die. Then the question is, then how to get rid of the subtle body? That is actually the question. That is actually the challenge. How to get rid of the subtle body? Subtle body doesn't die. And beyond that is the spirit soul, the spiritual body. Now, subtle body is made of what? Very good. So, when the mind is engaged in thinking about Krishna, mind business is to think. When the mind is constantly engaged in thinking about Krishna, then what happens to the mind? Mind is spiritualized. Mind is spiritualized. In this way, when one becomes constantly engaged in thinking about Krishna and serving Krishna, then Krishna gives him buddhi yoga, the intelligence which is to be engaged in devotional service. Like the verse goes, Teshang shatata yuktanang bhajatang priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogantam jena mamupajantite. Intelligence is buddhi, man, buddhi and ahankar. Man, what should he do with the man or the mind? Man mana bhava. Man mana bhava. With your mind you just think of me all the time. So by doing that, the mind is spiritualized. When one is engaged in constantly being engaged in serving Krishna, then his buddhi is buddhi yoga, spiritualized. And in this way, when one becomes engaged in serving Krishna, then what happens to his ahankar or false ego? Jiver swarup hai. So he gets into his swarup. So see, in this way, the mind, intelligence and false ego is transformed or spiritualized. So does he have a mind? Does he have an intelligence? Does he have a spirit? A false ego? No. At that time, he doesn't have any subtle body. So see, he has a gross body, he doesn't have a subtle body. Then what is happening? Swarup, he became engaged in serving Krishna, so he has become situated in his swarup or in his spiritual identity. Jiver swarup hai, Krishna nitya das. That then, his situation is like the pure spirit soul. The personality in his swarup is residing in that apparently gross body. That stage is called Swarup Siddhi. Swarup Siddhi. He is situated in his swarup. And then he is transformed. Another Jivan Mukta stage. He is Jivan Mukta. Iha yasya harer dasye karmana manasa gira. Karmana, his activities, manasa, his mind, karmana, his physical activities, his mind, gira, his speech, is engaged in service of Krishna. So nikhilasyapi avasthasu, in whichever condition he may be in, jivan muktasa uchyate. He is a jivan mukta, he is a liberated soul. Although in his apparently gross body. So that is the state of a pure devotee. When the body's subtle mental covering is destroyed by transcendental knowledge, the soul within the body again exhibits his original identity. Original identity is, his spiritual identity is, he is a servant of Krishna. Another example of life has been given here. What is the life like? Like a lamp. As long as there is oil, the lamp will burn. The moment the oil is finished, the lamp will get extinguished. So this body will last only as long as that oil is there. The vitality, vital energy is there, and then the life will be extinguished, and then the body will fall. And then Sukadeva Goswami gave a very nice instruction to Parikshit Maharaj, saying, you should fix yourself in meditation upon Lord Vasudeva, and thus the bite of the snake bird will not affect you. Fix your mind at Krishna's lotus feet, then the bite of the serpent will not affect you. So then finally, the snake bird came. The snake bird, Takshak, arrived in disguise of a Brahmana. It arrived in disguise of a Brahmana and came to bite. There is another story which is not in Srimad Bhagavatam, which is there in some Puran. And it could have been in Mahabharata actually also. So, Takshak was coming, and there is a snake doctor. There, his name is Kashyap. The snake doctor Kashyap, a sage, saintly personality. So he was going to Parikshit Maharaj. He thought, I will save the king. So, while he was traveling, he came across another Brahman. So they started to travel together. So he asked this other Brahman, in course of their travel, asked him, where are you going? He said, I'm going to Hastinapur. Oh, you're going to Hastinapur? Why do you want to go there? I'm also going there. So he said, I am going there because I heard that the king will be bitten by Takshak. So I am going there to protect the king, to revive him from the snake bite. So hearing that, this Brahmana, who was actually Takshak in disguise, he just became angry and assumed his form as Takshak. There was a huge banyan tree by the side of the road, and he said that you dare to counteract my poison? Saying that, he bit that banyan tree, and immediately the tree got turned into ashes. It got burnt into ashes. So he says, see, this is the potency of my poison. So do you dare to counteract that? So Kashyap said, fine. So he took some water in his hand, chanted some mantra, and sprinkled the water on the tree that turned into ashes. And immediately the tree came back to full formation. So Takshak was quite alarmed. But he said, look, you may be able to counteract the poison, but this time, this Parikshit Maharaj has been cursed by a brahmana. You may counteract my bite, but you won't be able to counteract the curse of a brahmana. So don't waste your time. I know why you're going to the king to revive him, because you need money, you need wealth. So take this wealth. So he gave him a box of gems, priceless gems. So the snake went away. So this is how Parikshit Maharaj's end was coming. And the snake god Taksha came in disguise of a brahmana and beat Parikshit Maharaj. And the body of the saintly king immediately turned into ashes. When that happened, when Parikshit Maharaj's son, Janmejay, got to know that his father has been killed. By the way, when Parikshit Maharaj left his body turned into ashes. But what happened to him? He went back to Krishna, went back to Godhead. So, Janmejay, the son of Parikshit Maharaj, wanted to take revenge, and he decided to kill all the snakes, destroy all the snakes. So he arranged a yajna, a sacrifice. And as a result of the sacrifice and the huge fire, the snakes were coming and falling into that fire and dying. Thousands, millions of snakes are just. And so now the priest was calling different snakes by the name, and he was falling there. Because in the heavenly planet, in the upper region, there are snakes, they are celestial snakes. I mean, they are powerful, very powerful snakes. The son of Kashyapa Muni. And so Janmejay, upon receiving his father's death, he began a sacrificial performance for the purpose of destroying all the snakes. And so he was calling, and now the brahmana chanted the mantra and said, let Taksha come and get burned in the sakrificial fire. Takshak was a friend of Indra. So Indra, in one hand, he was asking Takshak to come and fall in the fire, but Indra was arranging for him to counteract the mantra. So this is how Takshak was being saved. But then at one point, Indra could not do anything. This mantra became so powerful, and the Takshak was about to go. At that time, Angira Rishi's son, Brihaspati, came there, who is the guru of the demigods. And he told Janmejay, don't do that. Because in this world, everything happens due to the divine arrangement of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and the living entities, guna and karma. So in this way, by the advice of Brihaspati, who came to advise Maharaj Janmejay, took his advice and stopped that sacrifice. This is how Takshak was protected. Another thing he told him is that, you see, you won't be able to kill Takshak, because Takshak drank the nectar given by Indra. So this nectar makes one immortal. So you won't be able to kill Takshak. So Janamejaya then, according to the words of Brihaspati, he stopped the sacrifice. Anyway, so this is how the 12th canto ends. It goes on a little more, but they are not relevant. The story ends here. Parikshit Maharaj left his body. Janmajaya performed Sarpa Nidhan Yajna, the Yajna to kill the serpents. Many, many serpents were killed, but Brihaspati actually stopped him from killing the snakes. Thank you all very much. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Gaur Premanande Hari Hari. So maybe we can have a little kirtan and Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama, Rama. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama, Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama, Rama Hare. Nittai Gaur Hari Go, Hari Go, Hari Go, Hari Go. Jaya Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada, Prabhupada. Gaur Premanande Hari Hari. Nama Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Sarasvati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunnavadi Paschatta Deshatarine Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Gaur Premanande Hari Hari.
Thanks, everybody. So, as Guru Maharaj indicated, this is formally the end of the seminar. So, this evening, we have a slightly different program. Guru Maharaj already gave us a bit of an event. But before I speak about that, I'd like all of you to join me you have to chant three loud vocals in appreciation of